The library was my space, and there was just so much.
To the Harbor Grace excursion with the boys to have a time.
Hello, everybody. Bienvenue, and welcome to The Word on the Street in conversation with the 2023 Toronto Book Awards shortlisted authors. Thank you all for joining. A round of applause for yourselves. It's a beautiful Wednesday evening, and you're here with us, so we really appreciate it. My name is Sienna Tristen. I'm the programming manager at The Word on the Street and also your moderator and master of ceremonies for this evening. Thank you. Yes. Before we begin, I would like to speak to the history of the place we are gathered today. The city of Toronto exists because of the Toronto Purchase, also known as Treaty 13, signed with the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation in 1805 with a final claim settlement in only 2010. This territory is the subject of the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Belt Covenant, which is an agreement between the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and the Mississaugas of the New Credit to care for and share the resources around the Great Lakes in peace, which we all now share responsibility in upholding. The Dish with One Spoon was born, in part, out of the Anishinaabe concept of all our relations, which is the awareness that we are connected to and reflected in all of the living and non-living beings around us. Toronto is now home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples with long histories on this land. And acknowledging this is only the first step in building a practice of land stewardship and Indigenous solidarity that honors these peoples. Tonight's entertainment didn't just pop out of the ether. There are many people who've had a hand in making it possible. The Toronto Book Awards would like to thank its partners, the Toronto Public Library, beautiful space, the Toronto Star, and the Word on the Street Toronto. The awards themselves could not happen without the thought and care of this year's jury, Kateri Akewenzidam, Jamila Kanom Alidna, Stephen W. Beatty, Sue Carter, and Karen Lee. From my end, I'd like to thank this evening's bookseller, A Different Book List, who you'll see right over here. Hello, thank you. As well as the authors who will be spending the next hour with us. I'd also like to thank the Word on the Street donors, especially those who are in attendance tonight. It's individuals like you who help Watson hosting not only our annual festival, but also special programming like this, so we really appreciate you lending us a hand. If you're interested in joining our community and becoming a Story Street donor, you can do so on our website or through Canada Helps. Thank you, merci, and chimagwech to everybody involved tonight. So a quick bit of housekeeping to get everyone on the page before the main event. We'll be hosting the Toronto Book Awards authors in two 30-minute sessions with a 5-minute intermission bio break in between. The audience Q&A will be happening after both discussions when all five attending authors will come join us back on stage. So be sure to note your questions down somewhere. I'll be the one running around passing a mic to you all. In addition to conversations with the authors, we've also prepared something of a community art project for you to engage with. Right over this table here, we have a memory map activity, which is essentially an opportunity for you to add your voice to a communal map of Toronto to note down a significant memory, something that means something to you in this city. We invite you to take part after the discussion if you haven't already, and while you're there, you can pick up your raffle tickets. That's right, we are raffling off one complete set of the Toronto Book Awards 2023 shortlist, all five books. You can check in at the map table to acquire a raffle ticket. If you don't have one already, you don't need to run and get it now. You can grab it at the 5-minute break. The winner will be announced at the end of both discussions during the closing remarks. Now, let's jump into why we're really here. To celebrate the enormous talent and skill of the 2023 Toronto Book Awards shortlist authors. Dionne Brand, unfortunately, was unable to attend tonight in person, but sent us a recording of her reading so we can still be nourished by her vibrant and passionate poetry. I will read the juror citation for nomenclature, and then we will play the clip. Perhaps you can join me in closing your eyes for a deeper listening experience. Nomenclature by Dionne Brand from Penguin Random House. Nomenclature documents 4 decades of witness, rages, history, and survival from richly decorated, multi-genre, global literary icon Dionne Brand. She famously asks her students, "Does the world need this line?" The pristine clarity of Dionne Brand's necessary lines are defiant experiments from a legendary imagination at once ancestral and singular. The city of Toronto is given voice, character, an eye in this staggering inventory. Her luminous oeuvre investigates cities mapping beauty, language, coloniality, bloodshed, black queer gender identities, and place within a liberatory politic. Dion Brandt's profound lines are exquisite blades which insist, disturb, confront, demand without apology our eardrums.
The apocalyptic reports have come true, dilute in our arterial solvent. The atrocities saturate our latent notebooks. We stay awake, lambent. There are iridium rectangles under our tables. We meet, languid, nauseous, transfused presently for a few decades, chronic, venous, insufficient. The intervals of talk speed to nothing. And we've become scientists of without, under force, out of water, across loading, with bearings of us. Nothing will come from our innocence, you know that, after all. No discoveries in old texts, no modern symmetries, no revelations, no wisdoms to be admired. Messages to be deciphered, smuggled to each generation, or so prescient, they require philosophers. These were not clandestine works. There are no secret hallways waiting for the transcriber of great portents. It's simple. The wars they recorded were the wars they won. Let me be plain with you. These portraitures are portraitures of what we suspect. The insoluble facts are these, then. No one carried their writings across a river in a ringed cloth on the head, or sewn into the precious fold of a hem. No one buried them in a desert to wait for a coruscating time. The illuminated manuscripts are just the gaudy sacredness of violence. The electronic leeches downloaded their data bulk. I, for one, understood this eventually. My tendons were xenolith. By then, of course, the tectonic plates zigzagging, shivering against us. There was that time, in a room on Calle Nueva, when the world crushed my chest like the world, like a boulder, as if the world were a boulder, as if gravity knitted sternum to finger, to hill, to lip, to thread, to floor, to chair, to boat, to gull, to Calle Nueva Alta, to thought, to hem, to a bus, to three note pencils, to umbrella, to foot, to insect, to jaw, to stem, to emate lagoon nebula, to deneb, to fish, to velocity, to sheet, to wing, to light socket, to metal rail, to postage, as if gravity melted oxygen tank, to grief, to hip, to shoreline, to chair, to drinking glass, to green light, to xiphoid, to November, to tailpipe, to insect, to transcriptome. I know everything. I'm not innocent. It was 5 p.m. all day that day. The sky. If I say the sky's small arithmetic, its inscription, its echo, through one undone instance and the other, we discovered new diseases traveling the floor of our tissue. We leathered these in catalogs of our antigens, what with one thing and another. I am only ever uttering every other word, skirting all articulations shaped by ideology. Wary of this, understand, it has been several winters to the next.
Thank you very much. A round of applause for the spirit of Dion Brandt. Very powerful stuff. Now at this time, I would like to invite our first set of authors to the stage. Please join me in welcoming Wanda Nanibush, Georgiana Uhlyarik, and Carolyn Whitzman. Wanda Nanibush is an Anishinaabe Kwai image and word warrior, curator, and community organizer from Beausoleil First Nation. Currently, Nanibush is the inaugural curator of Indigenous art and co-head of the Indigenous and Canadian Art Department at the Art Gallery of Ontario. Her retrospective exhibition, Robert Houle, Red is Beautiful, is on at the Smithsonian NMIA in Washington, D.C. She's curated numerous exhibitions, including Radical Remembrance, the sculptures of David Rubin, Pictokun, in 2023, this year, Portrait of Desire, Rosalie Favell, Rebecca Belmore, Facing the Monumental in 2018, the J.S. McLean Center for Indigenous and Canadian Art, also in 2018, and Rita Letendre, Fire and Light in 2017. Nanibush founded Aba Quad, It Clears After a Storm, in 2018, a unique annual Indigenous-led conversation on Indigenous art by those who create, curate, and write about it. The gathering alternates annually between Toronto and international venues. It most recently took place in 2022 in partnership with the Sami Pavilion at the Venice Biennale. Nanibush works on collection diversification and institutional decolonialization in museums. Her recent co-authored book is Moving the Museum, Indigenous and Canadian Art at the AGO, which showcases some of this work. Nanibush has a Master's of Visual Studies from the University of Toronto, where she has taught graduate courses. On top of many catalog essays, Nanibush has published widely on Indigenous art, politics, history and feminism, and sexuality. Georgiana Uhlyarik is the Frederick S. Eaton Curator of Canadian Art and co-lead of the Indigenous and Canadian Art Department at the Art Gallery of Ontario in Toronto, Canada. Woo! Ooh, it's quite loud. Prior to joining the AGO, Uhlyarik held various roles at the McMichael Canadian Art Collection, the Power Plant, Mercer Union, and the Gershon Iskowitz Foundation. She works collaboratively with artists and curators from across the Americas and Europe with a focus on women artists. Uhlyarik served on the board of the Association of Art Museum Curators and is adjunct faculty in art history at York University and the University of Toronto. Originally from Romania, she lives in Toronto with her twin sons. Welcome. Thank you. And last but not least, Carolyn Whitzman is a writer and researcher who lives in Ottawa. She came all this way for us tonight, so extra special thank you for that. She is the author of Suburb, Slum, Urban Village, Transformations in Parkdale, Toronto, 1875 to 2000. She was living in Parkdale when she stumbled upon Clara Ford's story and has remained fascinated with it for more than two decades. So we're going to hear a little bit from each of these books. I'll read the juror citation and then we'll enjoy an excerpt together. We're going to start with Moving the Museum, edited by Wanda Nanibush and Georgiana Uhlyarik by Goose Lane Editions. Moving the Museum is revelatory. The book challenges and provokes readers to question and reestablish their relationships with Indigenous art by presenting new ways for museums to present and interact with Indigenous communities and artists. This book kicks the colonial gaze to the curb, insisting instead that museums and galleries radically shift what they've been doing and offers page after page enacting the potential of Indigenous art to empower, inspire, and create community. Wanda Nanibush has taken up her role as a steward of Indigenous art at Toronto's Art Gallery of Ontario and uses it here to present deeply grounded and transformative Indigenous knowledge in an accessible way, while Georgiana Uhlyarik and other AGO colleagues offer support essential to enacting real change. Moving the Museum is an art book that is practical, radical, and necessary.
Thank you. Thank you. I hope you can all hear me. I think I'm going to start. First, I just want to thank the jury, thank everybody for coming here this evening in this glorious building. It's one of my favorite places in Toronto. I'm just going to say a little bit about the publication. It kind of reflects the way that Wanda and I work, and so what we've chosen to do this evening is read short excerpts. We're basically walking through the same space.
Go ahead. Oh.
It's what happens every day. we walk through the same space and we give you different perspectives so that really it's as though you are moving with us through the galleries. And in the J.S. McLean Center for Indigenous and Canadian Art that opened 2018, one of the first rooms you encounter is a space called The Self. And I need my glasses because I'm 51. Okay. The Academy, 2008, a large canvas by Kent Monkman, features the artist's alter ego, Miss Chief Eagle Testicle, wearing the wedding dress of Harriet Bolton Smith, along with images appropriated from numerous well-known works from the AGO's Canadian collection, such as After the Bath by Paul Peel. Installed diagonally across from Bolton Smith's wedding portrait and into the next room, Monkman's painting, commissioned for Transformation AGO, is a touch point between the 2008 installation and our reimagining of the J.S. MacLean Center for Indigenous and Canadian Art a decade later. Around the corner from the Harriet Bolton Smith portrait hangs a more recent acquisition, Portrait of Mabel Cawthra. Swiss-born Mabel Cawthra Adamson belonged to a wealthy family that relocated to Toronto, growing up in a large mansion just north of the Grange on Beverly Street. Her mother held literary salons in their home, often frequented by E. Pauline Johnson, the famed Mohawk writer and performer. And it's actually quite magical that I'm speaking about Mabel Cawthra here, because upstairs on the top floor are her archives that were donated by her grandson. In this large-scale portrait, Cawthra is 21 years old and already well-traveled to Asia, North Africa, and Europe. She purchased the ornate chair on which she sits during her journey, signaling her worldliness. Confident, elegant, and talented, Cawthra married in 1899 at St. George de Grange Church, located at the southeast corner of Grange Park, and became a commanding presence in Toronto's arts community. Adamson was one of the leading advocates for the role of women in fine and applied arts, co-founding several artist societies, collecting art, and supporting local artists and art institutions, as well as running a successful interior design firm. Adamson, along with a handful of progressive artists such as Florence Carlisle, Mary Heaster Reed, whose paintings are featured in the same space, opened up new professional opportunities for the next generation of women artists. They drew strength from each other in what was then a very young artistic community in Toronto. Five paintings might at first glance appear simply as a delightful, modest group of interiors. Each quiet, contemplative, and unassuming in its own way, they depict various intimate spaces close up. Yet upon further reflection, they reveal that they are more than lived-in rooms. They are active sites of work. These are artist studios, sometimes private, sometimes social, always productive. More than interiors, these paintings function as portraits of the artist's interior lives as manifested in their working spaces. Helen McNichol, Christiana Pflug, and Mary Heaster Reed each distinctly assert their identity as an artist, claiming a space they made their own. Installed in the self room, along with a pair of related Florence Carlisle canvases, these paintings speak to an era of strict social norms that circumscribed women's self-determination and limited their freedom. In subtle yet insisting ways, they each reveal a rebellion against patriarchal expectations and a reveling in self-expression. In contrast, the painted collage of a flowery Victorian dress against a frozen landscape of the Rocky Mountains by Joanne Todd exerts its overt sexuality via a literal slitting of the canvas. Slitted hat is a pair of legs spread apart and wearing spiked heels, an image the artist appropriated from a pornographic magazine and used as a guide for the shape. The transgression in this work activates details in the older canvases. Suddenly, the upturned soft fold of deep red fabric at the bottom of the woman's dress in Carlisle's The Tiff uncovers new layers of interpretation. Being able to see the underneath of one of Cawthra's shoes may now appear as a willful indiscretion made more mysterious by the fallen white rose petals. Thank you.
So I also just want to thank the Toronto Book Awards jury and for your festival also for having us and for the library. And Jim Shedden's at the back, who's been the head of publishing at the AGO for a very long time and has done an amazing job. And he knows that I tend to write and write and write and write. And so I can't read and read and read this evening. So I can't even read this whole section. So you're going to get a little taste of me. At the center of the thematic room, the self, Yawit Wiyu, is a performance artifact and sculpture called Rising to the Occasion by Anishinaabe artist Rebecca Belmore. This reimagining of a Victorian tea dress was created and worn by Belmore on July 17, 1987, in 12 Angry Crinolines, a parade and video performance in Thunder Bay organized by Lynn Sharman that protested the colonial nature of the visit of the Duke and Duchess of York. Prince Andrew and Sarah Ferguson. It was truly disappointing to Belmore to see the royals going to a reconstructed fur trade fort, riding in a birch bark canoe, instead of learning about the colonial realities of the Anishinaabe and Cree who live in the area. The angry crinoline Belmore created had a beaver dam bustle at the back, a Victorian gown at the front, complete with tea saucers as breastplates, and kitschy royal wedding souvenirs caught in the beaver dam at the back. Belmore remade the dress for the AGO between 1990 and 1991, when it entered the collection. As it is seen, it is seen as a sign of the previous performance and as a contemporary sculpture in its own right. A headdress of braids sticking straight up into the air hangs above the dress, which creates a sense of the body that inhabited the piece. The work is a serious critique of colonialism, Victorianism, and a culture of amnesia, while also offering a humorous take on protest and performance. Because you know, if we were angry, our braids would stick straight up. Rising to the Occasion satirizes the Victorian morality that is still part of British Canada. The nickname Toronto the Good was coined by William Holmes Holland, the former mayor, who was an anti-vice, anti-gambling, anti-liquor, and Bible thumper. The AGO was born of, I didn't write that, somebody else did. The AGO was born of the Victorian era through a gift of the owner of the Grange House, Harriet Bolton Smith, who you've already heard about. This was a time when power and whiteness were being consolidated and art played its part. For many cultures that feel excluded from museums like the AGO, this bourgeois middle-class culture, which began at the height of Victorian colonialism and continues today, is one of the reasons. Bodies that protest, laugh, get angry, feel emotion, act out, are loud, or belong to brown women, like the body hinted at in the Belmore work, have largely not been acceptable inside the museum. It's a shock they hired me. Following the artist's lead, it felt radical to place these bodies at the center and ask how doing so changes the way we see them represented in our Canadian art collection. Placing our collection on placing our collection of historical Canadian portraiture next to these contemporary works, the historical takes on contemporary relevance. Suddenly, the flip up of a deep red dress hem on the tiff by Florence Carlyle takes on connotations of illicit or suppressed sexuality. In a society where women are defined in relation to men in their family and later their husbands, their desires are constantly suppressed. Carlyle was a woman who defended these rules in 1890 at the age of 26. Defied, shit, not defended. We really need defied. You have to get that about her. In a society where women are, in 1890, at the age of 26, she moved to Paris, renting a flat and expanding her artistic skills. She lived in New York and London as a painter. I'm gonna skip. No society or person is completely transparent. There are hidden desires, intrigues, and suppressed ways of being, and deep oppressions of other cultures and peoples deemed uncivilized based on their differences. This drama can take place in art through the presentation of an audacious sexuality. The presence of The Academy by Kent Monkman reinforces this idea. The two-spirited, queer, cross-dressing figure of mischief, wreaking havoc on Western art histories, bending time, mixing genres, brings us to question both the histories we are so deeply attached to, because they form our identity, and whether seeing them otherwise can create new avenues for self-exploration and transformation. Placing a two-spirited figure in the center of this drama also hints at other erased sexualities and genders that existed before colonialism. These Indigenous artworks reverse the marginalization of performance art within the museum. Performance art has been taken up as a challenge to Western categorizations of art that remove the living body from art, and also as a challenge to the market's intrusion into the art world through the fetishization of the object. Big words. By entering history from the vantage point of performance, we can look at portraiture as a performance of power and at the ways women played a part in it as they struggled to release themselves from the confinement of patriarchy. That's all right.
Water at any time if you need it.
Just throw it on me, I'm hot.
Let's move in right along. So the other book up on stage, the other author up on stage with us is, of course, Carolyn Whitzman with Clara at the Door with a Revolver by On Point Press, which is an imprint of UBC. Carolyn Whitzman did not set out to tell the story of Clara Ford when she began researching class structure in Parkdale during the mid-20th century and discovered newspaper clippings about a black woman who was accused of murdering a wealthy white man in the West End neighborhood. Bridging together coverage from the day with deep research and a page-turning narrative, not only does Whitzman's book reveal this little-known incident in Toronto's history, but it will also leave readers hungering for more of the city's stories to be recast through a modern lens.
Hi, everyone. I'd also like to thank the jury. I'd like to thank the organizers from Word on the Street and also from the City of Toronto. I'm so overjoyed to be in my favorite building in Toronto, where I did a lot of the research for this book and for previous history that I've written. And you know, I just want to pay tribute to Raymond Moriyama because his great work lives on. So as Sienna said, Clara Ford, this is a biography of Clara Ford as well as a true crime story. Clara Ford went on trial in 1895. She was a 33-year-old black tailor who was accused of murdering her former next-door neighbor, an 18-year-old white young man named Frank Westwood. Now, I'm about to read from the end of her trial. There is no spoiler here. I say on the first page, she was acquitted. She was the first woman and second person to testify on her own behalf. She was the first person that I found in 1894 who was described as a homosexual in a newspaper. Article that happened to be written by my chief villain of the piece, Hector Charlesworth, who was a journalist for one of the seven warring newspapers called The World, and actually he co-founded the Arts and Letters Club, as I found out last week. So that was a lot of the colonial past of Toronto is still very close to us, right? Okay, I'll just launch into the reading now. The Globe once again said it best. The audience settled down for a long wait, the general impression being that the judge's charge had been so strongly against the prisoner that it would either result in a prompt conviction or a long fight by those favorable to her. As they waited, little groups all over the courtroom laughed and chatted as though it was between the acts of a comedy. But sometimes one member of the group would glance at the prisoner, note her hopeless expression, and the little group would become quiet again. The telegram added that Johnson retired from the courtroom while Mr. Murdoch sat idly playing with a pencil. Benjamin Westwood, the murdered man's father, sat with folded arms and head slightly bowed, lost to the sights and sounds around him. The hands of the old clock on the west wall of the dingy old courtroom, which is still there, by the way, on Adelaide Street, went slowly around on their accustomed journey while the chimes from St. James Cathedral pealed a quarter past nine, half past nine, a quarter to ten. The intermission was surprisingly short. After exactly 1 hour and 3 minutes, the Mail and Empire reporter loved his watch, a rap-rap from the jury room signaled its return. The constable summoned his lordship to resume his place on the bench. The cathedral clock pealed out that it was 10 p.m. There was an ominous hush of those who felt the woman was doomed. The court clerk asked the jury foreman, Joseph White, a wagon maker from Markham, "Gentlemen of the jury, have you reached your verdict?" "We have," said the foreman, rising to his feet. "How say you of the prisoner at the bar? Is she guilty or not guilty?" "Not guilty," came the prompt reply. Spectators gasped, and those at the back of the court began to cheer. Soon everyone joined in. Benjamin Westwood sighed and put his face in his hands. Chancellor Boyd sat quietly writing to the sound of foot stomping and hand clapping. After several minutes, the court clerk rose. "Gentlemen of the jury, hearken to your verdict as the court records it. You say the prisoner at the bar is not guilty, and that is the verdict of you all? Several jurors nodded, rousing another cheer from the back of the court. As for Clara, the Globe reported, as those words which gave her back her life and liberty fell upon the prisoner's ear, she sat motionless, as if unable to comprehend her good fortune, and then sank back into the corner of the dock with a deep sigh. And as the plaudits of the crowd burst forward a moment later, she glanced round with a pleased and gratified smile. The cheers subsided, and the Chancellor commanded Clara Ford stand up. Clara stood, and Boyd read from the statement he had hastily composed. The jury has acquitted you of the crime with which you are charged. I am not surprised at the result, and for your sake, I am glad. I am not sorry at the verdict, because it has cleared your character, and also the character of that poor young fellow who is dead. Let me say one word more. Be kind to the little girl, Florence Mackay, who's always shown her love for you, though she was compelled to testify against you. I ask you to be kind to her, treat her gently and lovingly. You are free. Boyd got in the last word. The case was about Frank's reputation, not Clara's life, and my goodness, wasn't she a bad mother? Clara met the eyes of the judge who'd tried to condemn her to hang an hour earlier and gave him a little bow and a smile. She said, in the clear and ringing tones she'd used throughout the trial, thank you, sir. A lifetime of forced deference lay behind those simple words. From that moment, all order and decorum, all Toronto-ness was thrown to the winds. The constable's shouts went unheeded as the spectators rushed the dock to shake hands with the liberated woman. Among the first to congratulate her were her counsels, William Murdoch and Blackie Johnson. Then Eliza Reed pushed her way through the crowd, threw her arms around Clara's neck, and kissed her. With a hand at Clara's back, Eliza ushered her outdoors. As she exited the courtroom, a well-known bookmaker said to his companion, I touched her dress as she passed me, for luck, you know. Clara, face radiant, used both hands to greet her well-wishers. An estimated 200 men and boys accompanied her west to York Street, along the famed four blocks on Adelaide Street she'd traversed 5 months earlier. At that time, her suit of men's clothes was in an evidentiary bundle, her revolver was in Sleeman's pocket, and her heart was in her throat. Now she was half carried by the crowd as it moved towards the Dorsey's restaurant and Clara's home. Just before Young, the crowd came across a newsboy selling a special edition of the Star. Someone handed Clara a copy, and she read, Set Free by the Electric Light. If I could stop this narrative to take a photograph of Clara, it would be at that moment.
Thank you, all three of you, for your readings. I'd love to just close my eyes and hear you deliver your own words, because you know best where to put the emphasis and where to laugh at your own jokes. So let's jump right in. All of these works do really interesting things with linearity. You know, Moving the Museum describes doing away with the chronological rehang of what was in the museum, and in so doing, doing away with the notion of linear time, right? And also in Clara, you bounce back and forth with facts over the better part of two centuries to eventually build up layer on layer of personal stories and relationships that eventually build to this trial. So these ways of working with history are more challenging than like a clear-cut, you know, monomythic story, but ultimately they're more honest, right? So I wanted to know a little bit about the process of organizing those many complex elements, whether they are research documents or oil paintings and sculptures, into a larger body of work. You know, like what were some of your primary curatorial considerations as you were putting these works together? Would we start with Carolyn? Is it okay if we start with you?
Sure.
Okay.
Well, when I originally stumbled across the story of Clara Ford, I decided that I would read the 7 newspapers in order. I'd start with the day that she was, the day of the murder, and I'd end, well, with the last sighting I had of Clara. But then I realized that I wasn't really interested in, I was interested in the case, but I was more interested in Clara. And it was really important to me to introduce Clara's life at the right point. So I start out in, and I'm very consciously, because I, one other thing about Clara, after she was acquitted, she actually joined the first all-black burlesque theater company in North America and toured as a dancer. At the age of 33, she took up a new career as a dancer, which is, again, you know, she was a very remarkable woman. So where was I going to introduce Clara's life? So I had to start off with, you know, the murder and the immediate aftermath of the murder, the 6 weeks until Clara was, until the decision was made that she was the best suspect for 19th century Toronto, and then go back and go, who is Clara? And when I went, who is Clara, I needed to paint a scene of what it was like to be a mixed race woman in 19th century Toronto. So I needed to talk a little bit about what Toronto was like. The narrative goes back and forth a little bit, although I was very conscious of writing a narrative nonfiction and hopefully drawing the reader on where they, to the point where they were really interested in Clara and then really interested in how Clara is going to manage to escape death.
Escape Toronto.
She wanted to live in Toronto. I'm not sure Toronto wanted her to live there,
yeah.
But she wanted to live in Toronto.
Yeah. Georgiana?
I think what I would like to share is that, you know, the magical thing about art, and why I have been so committed to it for such a very long time, and I mean visual art in particular, is that we actually always experience it in the contemporary moment. And it really is this moment where you get to reach across, and the consciousness of the person, whether they're from the 17th century or from yesterday, that you get to actually have this magical conversation with them. It's a one-on-one encounter. You know, Wanda was talking about that performative body, like you actually are in this encounter, in this direct encounter. And so it's a way, it's in a way kind of easy to undo with the chronology, because chronology is just sort of category of Western thought, and that it's like we're used to it, and we experience, of course, time in a, you know, one moment after the other.
Three-dimensional way.
Yes, although apparently that's also false. If I knew anything about physics, I would explain to you how that's totally wrong. And we experience everything all at once. I think you just shift it. You just sort of shift that expectation, but you also have something that people can hold on to. So this one after the other, so-and-so begets so-and-so, is only familiar to some people in a particular kind of epistemology. And so we just have to shift that a little bit and offer people this direct encounter where that they're in charge of. Because everything of that consciousness is already in that work. The artist put everything that they wanted to put in that work. And so it's there. So we just want to create this opportunity for you to encounter them.
I think that chronologies can't ever include us in our fullness and what we make as artists, as creators. So for me, they just don't work.
Toss it out, try again.
Totally. And then when you break, because if we're included, it's just a fucking canoe in the 1800s, and then we are like some beadwork here and there, you know? It's not interesting to me to be just that, because it's not how we experience our history or ourselves or our creativity. Sorry if swearing offends you. Not really sorry, though.
Perfunctorily sorry.
But there was a moment, I think in my own life, when I realized it's like, the thing I love about contemporary art is that it definitely defies time. I think really great artists, they can see the future in the present, so they can capture things that we can't quite see, and they bring them forward. And it's the same with the past. They can see a past that hasn't come to be yet in when they go into archives or things like this. So really the endeavor and the breaking of time is really about creating new futures for more of us.
It's just funny you mentioned that because the last time I was actually here, I live in Hamilton, I don't live in the city. The last time I was here watching an event on the stage was Jeremy Dutcher doing a conversation about his album, which had recently come out, and like it was such a fabulous time. And I think about how he's pulling from archives and making futurisms out of them. So yeah, mm-hmm. It's very cool stuff. I saw the little 5-minute left sign, which is just like, so I despair, because I want to talk to you for an hour, right? We don't have that kind of time.
Do it this way, I despair.
That's right, I despair, okay. But I do have one question for you that I do really want to get to, given that these are all shortlisted books for the Toronto Book Awards, I want to get a Toronto question in there, you know? So I wanted to ask about both of these books. All of the shortlist really engages deeply with reframing, reclaiming, and retrieving narratives. Some that have been in obscurity, some that need to be retold by the people who claim them as their own. So what are your hopes for how these books are going to influence or inflect upon readers' experience of Toronto as a city? You know, like if your work is in conversation with the city, what's the tone of that conversation? What's the theme of it as you stand right now? Because again, it's always changing. Can I go in reverse order? Can I start with you, Wanda?
Sure. I mean, I'm influenced because the first show I did at the AGO was Toronto Tributes and Tributaries 1971 to 1989. So I sort of started by thinking about Toronto art and what was missing, what's canonized, what isn't, that kind of thing. I love Toronto because of it. It is one of the most diverse cities in the world. But it also, unfortunately, is still super British in these ways that are quite oppressive. And so I think with this, what is her, what is me? It's sometimes confusing. But I know for myself, it was important to bring that aspect out. Mm. Toronto is actually quite a sexy city, you know, in its own way.
That's a hot take. Say more. <It's> like
or it could be if you looked in other areas. But the thing I love about, it's like a human being. It's not one thing. Yeah. And it's not. It doesn't know itself like we don't know ourselves completely. There are areas that are blind, we're blind to, and so it takes other people to see them. Or if somebody comes into the city that, say, needs, like, bathhouses or something, you know, they know, like, there is a pathway to that. Mm. There's ways in which you can satisfy any kind of desires that you need. And then, so in art, like in when we curated the piece, I believe in allowing audiences the same kind of freedom to find their own narratives, to find their own interests. I don't really tell them where to go or what to look at. And so I think it mirrors the city and what I think the city is, which is a series of buried tributaries, you know?
Yeah. And it is true about the way in which you can discover the city in your own way and that you find your place in it. It's a large city. It's a gorgeous city, it's an ugly city, it's all the things. And I'm only going to add that in thinking about how the book kind of connects to the city is that I think about the responsibility that we hold at the Art Gallery of Ontario because very often, most often I would argue, that most kids, most people will encounter art, if you like, with this glorious capital A, at the Art Gallery of Ontario. And so what is the responsibility that we have to make sure that people are reflected, that people feel connected, and that we also question the history out of which it came? So that's how I would like for it to function, is to be the place where you can encounter yourself.
You spark that inquisitiveness.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Carolyn.
Yeah, you know, Toronto the good, Hogtown, Queen City. It's all very, very dull, the way that Toronto is described. But one of the sources I used was a wonderful young adult book called Underground Railway Next Stop Toronto by Afua Cooper and Carolyn Smart Frost, and there's a third author who I'm forgetting, unfortunately. Anyhow, it talked about ordinary
Black people's lives, and one of those people was William Hickman, who ironically was freed as a slave in the US because he fought in the War of 1812 against Canada, but then he became a refugee in the 1830s, about 1832, because his shop in Richmond, Virginia was firebombed. So he moved to Canada with his family, his young family, and one of his children was named Chloe, and she lived in Toronto when it was still York, muddy York. Mm. And Chloe grew up to become a educator of other black refugees, and she also owned a grocery store and a restaurant on York Street, and she married into the Dorsey family, another group who'd moved up from the US, and they did a lot of really amazing things, which I don't have time to get into. And she was Clara Ford's landlady at the time that she was arrested. And what I try to do through the story of Clara is take stories that I consider to be really interesting and really important and bring them to people, because it's really, you know, Toronto is really juicy. I don't know whether I can go quite as far as Wanda and call Toronto sexy, but...
Well, you just did. I mean, juicy. It doesn't get any sexy and juicy. It's got texture.
Let's go for sexy. Why not? So, you know, there's just so much there beyond the boring surface that we're taught about Toronto.
Yeah. Get out there and dig it up, everybody. This is what we're saying.
Well, dig up that juicy sexiness.
You heard it here first. Thank you so much. A round of applause for all three of our authors.
And can I just say one thing? Just as somebody who feels like books and writers saved my life growing up, I just want to thank you all for being here and still supporting it.
Hugely.
Mm. Round of applause for yourselves.
Thank you. At this time, I would like to invite Sheila Murray and Sophie Jai to the stage. Sheila Murray has worked in film production, documentary filmmaking, and television sound editing. In 2012, she moved to the not-for-profit sector and now leads a grassroots, volunteer-driven initiative that engages urban residents in adaptation to local climate change impacts. She has a BA in journalism and an MA in immigration and settlement studies. Her short fiction has appeared in many Canadian literary journals. Finding Edward was a finalist for the 2022 Governor General's Literary Awards and a long list nominee for Canada Reads 2023. It was a 2022 Globe and Mail Best Book and CBC Best Canadian Fiction. Now, Wildfires is Sophie Jai's debut novel. It is the winner of the 2023 Canadian Authors Association Fred Kerner Book Award and the 2019 Borough Press Prize. It was shortlisted for 2023 Kobo Emerging Writer Prize and longlisted for the 2019 Bridport Prize Award. Jai has been a writer in residence and visiting fellow at the University of Oxford, where she is currently doing her master's in creative writing and working on her second novel. She was born and raised in Trinidad, grew up in Toronto, and now lives between here and Oxford. So just like last time, I will read the juror citation for each book and then we'll get a taste of it. We're going to start with Finding Edward by Sheila Murray from Cormorant Books. Following his mother's death, a biracial Jamaican named Cyril Rowntree leaves his Caribbean home for the promise of a new life in foreign, the unfamiliar environs of Toronto. There, Cyril tries to fit into his new surroundings, earn enough money for his studies, and somehow create a family and community in an unknown and often threatening environment. When he discovers a cache of letters from a mixed-race man in the 1920s, he determines to find out all he can about the mysterious individual named Edward. In her debut novel, Sheila Murray has created a sharp and incisive study of black history in Canada from the Toronto neighborhood of The Ward in the early 20th century to the Atlantic Canadian community of Africville. Murray's supple prose and confident storytelling make Cyril's journey a fascinating and rewarding reading experience in a debut of uncommon power and pathos.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Thank you to the Toronto Book Awards, everybody involved, and the jurors especially. and word on the street, Sienna. Thank you. 2 days of rain signaled the end of winter, not its real finish because forecasts called for snow later in the week. It was Sunday night, and Mr. Lee's daughter was visiting, filling in at the store. For old time's sake, she'd said, take the night off. But Cyril felt tight as a drum, his rising anxieties uncontainable. He was painfully homesick, and he missed his mother with a longing that made him hollow. She was unreclaimable, passed on forever, and Cyril had never been able to satisfy himself as to where. But if he could be home right now in the Jamaican sunshine on his way to Brownstown, walking by fields of yam and cabbage, or under a moon with the tree frogs singing, then a heaven might seem a possibility. He wanted to belong to someone. He wanted to hold Black History Girl, and maybe if he could find the courage to work at fitting in, then life would be better. But he wasn't bold enough, he told himself, and so he used Edward as a distraction, and then he was ashamed of himself for blaming Edward. Cyril had a spring coat with a big rain hood, rain pants, and rubber galoshes from the Value Village bargain bin. He put them on and opened the door to the backyard. Wind shook the branches, whipped shadows through the light thrown by the motion detector, crude duppy shadows to frighten children, though they didn't scare Cyril. The night sounded of metal gutters rattling under the eaves of the house, a car alarm on an endless loop across the street, and the constant pounding rain. He pulled his hood over his head as he stepped onto the path. He had ID in his pocket and a $20 bill, safeguards. He needed only to walk off his restlessness, to make himself tired enough to forget how bad he felt so that he could get some sleep. He pushed into a fast walk, and a part of his mind had to focus on that, so it was harder to tell the difference between loneliness and anger. Anger was better for walking, physical, sharp, a pumped energy. Loneliness was just sad and depleted. Back home in Jamaica, Cyril had taught himself to find his way by holding on to the night, eyes closed. Now his eyes strained to see through the pouring rain. He would never trust Toronto well enough to close them. The rain was loud and his boots slapped through water. Now and then he pulled his hand from his pocket and tightened his hood. He walked in and out of pools of light falling from windows or street lamps. Car headlights made the sidewalks glow a dark red sheen. Silver bullets of rain burst on the ground. Red tail lights snaked by. Two guys swaddled in rain gear and riding hard on bicycles with little lights flashing appeared and were immediately swallowed again into the teeming, liquid dark. A dog pulled a woman by its leash while she struggled along behind with a broken umbrella. Cyril walked and walked, pounded out a rhythm that scrubbed his anger loose and into the rain. Night in a city of 2.5 million people where it's raining so hard that even those usually undeterred by weather, snow, wind, freezing rain, stayed home. Cyril pushed his legs faster, almost to a trot, and his body warmed with the effort. His mood began to turn. He was dry, though his feet worked double hard as they fought for stability in his rubber boots. It was time to turn back. He had got the comfort he'd known would come from walking. He always did. He pulled at the cuff of his coat to read his watch. Late enough already. Cyril hadn't seen the cop car before it slid alongside him. He always watched out for them, but his hood was drawn and his eyes focused straight ahead. He felt for the ID in his pocket, then pulled his hand quickly free and stood still, facing the car with his arms extended and his open palms facing front. Now he remembered the headlights in his face a minute or so ago.
Thank you, Sheila. The next book we have is Wildfires by Sophie Jai from the Borough Press. When her beloved cousin Chevy dies, Cassandra returns home to Toronto for the funeral. The big house on Florence Street is packed with her mother, sisters, aunts, a single uncle, and too many secrets to count. Why did Chevy never speak? Who was the man in the photograph hidden in her aunt's drawer? As the long, cold days pass, Cassandra excavates the corners of her memory and prods at the whirlwind of women, trying to piece together the narrative of her family.
Moving between Trinidad and Toronto, the past and the present, Jai sets her scenes precisely, and the tension leaps off the page. With thoughtful prose and absorbing characters, Sophie Jai's stunning debut cements her career as one to watch.
Thank you, Sienna. Thank you to everyone involved with the Toronto Book Awards, especially the Toronto Public Library, which was a safe haven for me as a child when I moved to Toronto when I was 10 years old. Frequented many libraries, including the Toronto Reference Library, which is where I wrote some of Wildfires. I've been up and down those elevators hundreds of times. So to be on the other side of it on this stage with such incredible writers and with everyone in the audience is a core memory in the making. So thank you so much. I'm going to read an excerpt that is a letter of unrequited love that is floating around the house in Wildfires. And there's usually, almost always, a letter of unrequited love in every house floating around. Plenty has gone. Plenty has gone. The things I gone through, the things I see, you wouldn't know. You couldn't guess. But why that is important for you to know is because the things that happen to me is also things that happen to you. It's possible that you don't even know what happened. But this is not something I want to talk about in a letter to you. These are things that really should be said to your face. In a way, it's sad when you think about it. Since I don't know if this letter will ever reach you, it's like I'm talking to myself, which is not something new to me. But in a way, it's good. It's only with myself I could talk honestly. It's only I alone who know what I mean when I say what I say. That is, until I meet you. Here is where I go write what I feel in plain English. I's not a poet. What I want to say is, there is a real rare thing to meet somebody and feel like you know them and they know you only within a few hours of the same day. I never had that feeling before in my life. Even though we only went out for that walk once, remember? It was getting dark and you was explaining to me the blues musician you like. And when I tell you I never hear the blues, you were shocked. And we start to laugh. That walk home feel like a lifetime, a whole next life, in a good way, eh? It was only a few hours and I still can't forget. Less than a day self. It's a hard feeling to let go. It's a strange thing to fail to forget something you can't explain. But maybe that is the reason self I can't forget. And it does bother me. Well, it's obvious it bothered me. I write in you 16 years since we first meet at the supermarket. Remember? Remember how we first meet? Please don't forget. Don't mind you meet plenty, plenty people since you and me meet, and plenty things happen to you and me since. Just don't ever forget. I myself could explain every detail of your face like I'd only see you 20 minutes ago. So that is the first thing I want to say. I sounding like one of them people in them romance books. But at least that gone out of my body. The second thing I want to say is, and I go say it in plain, bold-faced English so that you can't mistake what I saying is, why it wasn't me. I'm not saying that as a question, I'm saying that as a fact. Why you walk with me in the sunset so? Why you ask me questions about my father like you care? Why you bring me dandelions? You just bring dandelions and savanna flowers for everybody so? It must be so. Because when I did come to your apartment after I didn't hear from you, when you did gone and run and your landlord tell me you went to Caracas where you had sons, sons, I did nearly swallow my whole tongue right there. You had children and you didn't tell nobody? Look, I write down my question and answer it myself. You pick plenty flowers in your life. Don't get mad. Don't stop reading. I say nice things about you at the start. It's not like I hate you. I's mad at you and everything for the rest of my life, but I don't hate you. I tried so long to understand why you was the way that you was. I tried to say to myself, maybe he had a bad upbringing. Maybe his parents wasn't nice to he. Maybe something real bad happened to him, like it happened to me. And that is just how we turn out. He just bouncing from hair to there, not really thinking or feeling, but just moving, moving, always moving, so he don't have to sit still. Mm. I just think, what is it about sitting still that does scare this man? Why he always need to run? But I get tired. There was just circles I was running in my head, and eventually it started looking like one big zero. Maybe bad things did happen to you, but that is no excuse for what you do. I don't even know your real name, and he's connected to my nephews, to my sister, to me. But we's not strangers, you know. We's family now. I know it's not my place to say these things, but the things you do it to all of we. But we getting on. We getting on, and that is good enough. You absolve yourself of responsibility. You slap your hands from re, clean like we was dust. And for that, you must live in shame forever. If not by your own recognition, but then by we own. Go on and take a long, hard look in your mirror. Not that you need a mirror to see yourself. It's not how you sleep at night, but how you fall asleep. A guilty conscience don't need any accuser. I rel hope that if you decide to look at yourself, and it's never too late, he's never too old, if you decide to look at yourself, you must see yourself and forgive yourself so that a better man is born from the shedding. I did see him once. Thank you.
Thank you, both of you. So I want to jump right in and ask, I'm going to bookend this with Toronto questions, because you gave us a beautiful Toronto passage, and then the whole book is set at, like, in this house, you know, in this one sort of really interesting, like, potent space. How does Toronto emerge as a character in your books? Like, both protagonists, Cyril and Cassandra, are immigrants from different parts of the Caribbean. They meet the city on different terms from somebody who was born and raised in the fishbowl, you know, essentially, of the city. Through their eyes, what does the city around us right now appear to be? And, like, what are the layers and nuances that emerge to them as they move through it? Can I start with you, Sheila?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, I do think Toronto is so important to the book. I mean, there's a sort of, we are in Africville in Nova Scotia for a period of time, mm-hmm. and even out west briefly, and other places, but it's really Toronto is where the focus is. And I suppose that there are two characters. There's the Edward from the title of the book, who was born in the very early 20s, 1920s in Toronto. And then Cyril, who comes from Jamaica. Cyril, because of his research, so Cyril is looking for Edward's history. That's how he comes to know Toronto. So, for instance, there's a scene on a streetcar where Cyril sort of looks around him and thinks about some of the black folk who had, you know, sort of in the 1800s, who had been important people in a certain period of time, and had you know, really informed as Toronto history, actually, and Cyril understands that he's one of the few people who has this knowledge, and it's by virtue of having searched so hard for Edward's story. So I think for Cyril, Cyril can actually walk, you know, around City Hall and know that that's where the ward was. Understand that that's where a whole sort of very vibrant but very difficult. Lives were lived, and
there's like a superposition on top of the.
So not only is he can he sort of see Toronto in an objective way as an observer, as you were saying before, but also has this knowledge of deep time.
Yeah, deep time. I love that term. Yeah, for sure. And like to speak of discovery in this way, like as I heard both of your readings, a line that I connected that I hadn't previously connected, but I now want to ask you about, is like the intimacy of discovering people through their ephemera, like through their writings, through their photographs that they've like hidden away from people. Like, it's such an interesting way to meet people, especially in, you know, in Cyril's case, people you'll never meet face to face, people across time, the fourth dimension, you know. So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the uniqueness of writing characters who are relating to people in this sort of oblique way, you know, in this way that's so full of secrecy and sort of, you know, scuttling around the center of something that's very tender. Sophie, could we start with you again?
Yeah, of course. So I think, like many families, the family in this novel, they don't really like to talk about anything, especially the past, even though they're trapped by it. So the main character, she really does rely, she considers herself a detective in the family, an undercover detective.
They'd never have it if they knew.
Yeah, that's the thing. Even though she asks them questions blatantly to their face, they will just not answer it and, you know, not think of anything of it. But she really does rely on relics from the years past to try and piece together some sort of narrative to understand her current condition, which is an unhappy condition. She, you know, photographs, videos, memories that she's trying to piece together from her and her sisters to form one cohesive thought and sort of build a story on that. So the story that she's building throughout the book, it may very well be completely untrue. But
fictitious, yeah.
It may be. She doesn't know because no one will tell her. People are dying and time is running out to find out these stories. So she really only can rely on this physical evidence to curate a family story and thus curate her own story. And then she realizes that, you know, the history of her began before she was even born. And she has to imagine these lives. For example, from the letter that I read, she has to romanticize an entire story. She absolutely must to understand each person in her family if they absolutely refuse to talk. So it's interesting, the story that we tell ourselves to move forward, and if we're honest with ourselves or not about those stories.
Yeah, and like, what is truth anyway? Like, it's a whole other panel, but like, if it's helpful, is it true? Like, the pragmatics, and yeah, for sure. What about you, Sheila?
Yes, I suppose ephemera. So Cyril meets Edward through a photograph and some letters, some found letters, and a few other bits and pieces that were with them. And he, when he sees this photograph, which is of Edward as a you know, two years old Max, sitting in a chair, black and white, small thing, he doesn't just see an image, he feels a connection. And the connection isn't just that they both have brown skin, it's much more than that. It's a visceral thing. Mm. And one thing that Cyril does have, that's a little bit of magic that he, and he, you know, can claim as legitimate, you know, from his Jamaican background, which is that he, allowed in that setting in Jamaica to, not for everybody, but maybe spirits are a little closer, maybe they come a little closer. And so he has a connection that is deep and moving, and it's that connection it becomes a very important, in time, grows into a friendship, and that friendship with this character who he has never met and who would be so much older than him if he was still alive and probably you wouldn't notice on the street, is becomes so important to his experience of Toronto.
Yeah. I saw that we have 0 minutes, but I'm going to sneak in one more question for fun, because I said that I wanted to ask. Thank you, TPO. We're fine. We're safe. Don't worry. We have TPL immunity. It's okay. So what are your hopes? The same question I wanted to ask our fellow panelists. What are your hopes for how your books will influence or inflect upon readers' experience of this city that we know as Toronto? You know, what is the conversation that your book is having with the city right in the here and now? And Sheila, can we start with you to...
Well, that's huge.
I know,
question.
It's a whole other panel. And but I'm asking.
I can say this, and this is one of the things that people say to me, and it's a big deal. Mm. And what they say is, I'd never thought about that. Mm. And
That's a big thing.
And it's a big thing. Yeah. And I guess to, you know, to sort of expand on, I don't much, it matters because we're surrounded by people. We talked about how diverse Toronto is. We're surrounded by people who, well, each of us has a story. And we're certainly not going to consider or concern ourselves with everybody's single story, but to understand that there are this sort of this range of experience that's all around us, I think that's the thing that matters, something to think about.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep, echoing Sheila's thoughts exactly. So it's just one of the many stories of someone in Toronto, someone you walk by on the street who looks completely different from you or has a completely different background from you. You may share much more in common than you think. So, you know, Wildfire is it, there is the particular in the book. Yes, it's a Trinidadian family. That is the particular part of it. But there's also a universality in it, and that is grief and understanding oneself, and every single person can relate to that, regardless of your background.
I think so, yeah. Thank you both. A round of applause for Sheila Mary and Sophie Jai.